Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome you all to the fourth edition of BCCI Step Forward, a power session on happiness as a growth quotient. Before we formally begin the program, we would like to thank our partners. We would first of all like to thank Woodland Speciality Hospital Limited and the chairperson of this committee, Dr. Rupali Basu, for her constant support. We would like to thank our royal aging partner, Jagriti Dham, an initiative of Infinity Group. We would also like to thank our digital media partner, My Kolkata, The Telegraph Online. For the ease and smooth flow of the program, we would like to request all our participants to join through the Bengal Chamber Facebook and YouTube channel. And our panelists and our committee members have joined through Zoom. Any question which you want to put forward, please put it in the chat box so that we can address it during the question answer session. Ladies and gentlemen, my dear friends, on behalf of the Bengal Chamber of Commerce and Industry, it gives me immense pleasure to welcome you all to our fourth edition of BCCI Step Forward, a power session on happiness as a growth quotient, ideated by the Lifestyle Committee of the Bengal Chamber of Commerce and Industry, aiming towards good life and happy living. We are very much thankful to Ms. Dia Jaiswal, founder Empowerful, and Mr. Ronindo Dash, head marketing and corporate communication Infinity Group, for agreeing to be our speakers of this session and address us on the essentiality of happiness as a growth quotient. Their inspiring talk shall be really valuable for us because we believe that happiness is not a destination. It is a state of emotional well-being that a person experiences as a positive evaluation of one's life and accomplishments. This session would therefore focus on bringing about a transformative approach on how much to attain true happiness. Ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, I would now like to introduce our first speaker of the session, Ms. Dia Jaiswal. Ms. Dia Jaiswal is the founder of Empowerful. She is a certified life coach, happiness coach, NLP practitioner, counselor. Ms. Jaiswal is an alumni of Loreto House, Kolkata, and Lamartine for Girls, Kolkata, and an economic honors graduate from Lady Sriram College, Delhi. She began her career as a corporate investment banker with ANZ Grindlitz Bank and worked with them for 9 years. Motherhood came with its own challenges, and she changed career path, chose to wear the entrepreneurial hat for a better work-life balance and run a successful art gallery for many years. Ms. Jaiswal is a certified happiness coach, counselor, life coach, NLP practitioner. She describes herself as work in progress and consistently does not enhancement certification to upgrade her knowledge levels to stay absolutely dynamic. So once we start talking about Dia Jaiswal, it never ends. We are very much thankful that she has agreed to give us a glimpse of happiness. Without further ado, I would request Dia to please take it over.
Thank you, Sukanya. Thank you for your beautiful introduction. And a very warm welcome to all of you who have joined us here today. As Sukanya has said, happiness is the meaning of life, the purpose of life, and the whole aim of life. The best part is that it is within us all, and yet we are constantly looking for happiness, looking for that key to unlock, looking for someone who can switch on that light bulb for us, because it is the world's oldest pursuit, yours and mine too. So let me begin today by taking us all back to our childhood. The sentence, "and they lived happily ever after. Do you remember this sentence? I'm sure you do. It is very familiar to all, and it brings back many happy childhood memories, because it is the last line of fairy tales like Cinderella and Snow White and so many more stories that you and me have so loved to read throughout our childhood. And this happy ending, as we call it, has always given us a big happy smile on our faces. Therefore, it is not our fault that our mind is conditioned to believe that someday we too, like the characters in these stories, will reach a point where we will find happiness. Time passes, we grow up, but we continue on this pursuit of seeking happiness. Happiness becomes the goal of our life. But like Sukanya also said in her introduction, we need to remember happiness is not a goal. It is not your final destination. It is created within ourselves. And there is a science to it, which shows us that by practicing certain daily activities, we can experience happiness and live our life with fulfillment and success and achieve our goals. Now, as a society, we are all now coming out of the pandemic phase and adjusting to life in the new normal. We have together gone through a very difficult and challenging time in human history, and our stresses and our worries seem to have multiplied and compounded. A new study done in June 2022, as recent as that, in the US, shows us that 45% of people have not felt true happiness in these last 2 years, and 25% don't know or have forgotten what it means to be truly happy. Moreover, if you do a simple keyword search on Google for the word happiness, you will find that almost 1 million people do the same thing and search for ways to be happy on Google every single month. Happiness is one of the most Googled words today. This is because happiness impacts every aspect of our life, our relationships, our well-being, productivity, career, overall success, health, even how long they're going to live. So, you know, I feel that our minds, they are like Velcro for negativity and like a Teflon for positivity. Let me repeat that. Our minds are like Velcro for negativity and like Teflon for positivity. I'm going to explain this with an example. So if you're at an event or a social get-together and you meet and you interact with a whole bunch of people that you know, and you hear 5 good things about yourself and 1 negative thing, chances are when you go out of that room and you go home, you will remember and think of only that 1 negative comment. Am I right? This is quite normal. And we all tend to do this because we have an emotional tendency where the negatives tend to leave a stronger mark than the positives in our mind. Now, today we all know how important it is to follow a physical fitness regimen, and we go to the gym or we do some kind of daily exercise to stay fit and physically healthy. We also know the importance of our stomach health, so we make conscious, healthy food choices. We eat green, and our mornings often begin with the green smoothie. And many of us are becoming vegan now. That's the new mantra, right? But the most important thing that we need to manage and nurture is our emotional health. And there are simple daily practices and exercises that we can do to train and cleanse our mind to stay emotionally healthy. And I call this the Happiness Gym Workout, where you have a disciplined approach and you do daily exercises to strengthen your happiness muscles. Today, psychology is no longer inside a black box, and conversations on mental health are no longer the elephant in the room. There is a definite shift in the approach to mental health. And today, it's okay to say that you are going to see your therapist, your life coach, or your happiness coach. And workshops and sessions like this are definitely the way forward. Now, as a happiness coach, I'm always asked, Dia, are you going to make me more happy? And I have a very simple answer. No. Now, please don't put off your computers or leave this meeting. But the honest truth is that I cannot make you happy. And not because I don't want to, but never believe anyone who says that they can make you happy. Because the only person who can make you happy or unhappy is you. So we need to stop outsourcing our happiness and unhappiness to people and to circumstances. We need to stop blaming others for our unhappiness. Because as long as we make our unhappiness or happiness the job of other people and events, it will always remain unstable. Think of yourself like a television screen. So how does a television screen get controlled? With a remote, right? So don't give that remote control to any person other than you. Always keep your remote with yourself. So, you know, when we were growing up earlier, we were told and we believed that success brings us happiness. If we work really hard, we will get what we want, make a lot of money, and be really happy. However, today, we now know that it is actually the other way around. If you want to be successful, you have to work on being happy. In fact, it is the key ingredient for your success. Studies have shown us that there is a 13% increase in productivity when you are happy, because then you work better, you're more social, you're more connected, and you're more resilient. So for all of us at the workspace, and we spend 1/3 of our time at work, which in numbers is approximately 90,000 hours per lifetime. Do let that statistic sink in. It's a lot of work hours, right? So happiness should definitely be our priority. But it wasn't too long ago that being happy at work wasn't a big deal at all. Work was just a four-letter word after all. And if you didn't like your job, you did it all the same and you found your happiness outside the office. But we now live in different times. We now know and understand that there is a direct link between happiness and productivity. And let me give you some more statistics. Like I said, happy employees are 13% more productive. They also commit twice as much time to their tasks. Happy employees have a 65% more energy than the unhappy employee. Companies with happy employees outperform their competitors by 20%. Happy sales employees drive 37% more sales. Happy employees take 10 times fewer sick days and stay in their jobs 4 times longer than unhappy employees. So therefore, employee happiness counts for a lot. And clearly, having happy employees isn't just a bonus. It is now a necessity for every successful workplace. Because as you can see, production, motivation, dedication, and retention all depend on it. That is why happiness is the new corporate currency. And we've all reached a point like today where we are here together, formally recognizing the currency of happiness as a growth quotient. You know, many of the business leaders and the entrepreneurs that I meet are skeptic about this happiness concept. And they often point out to me and say, everyone in my office looks very happy. So how does my organization understand and identify the need to focus on this aspect? My answer to this is, companies are not usually able to identify that they are facing a happiness challenge. Instead, companies typically observe and identify that they are facing growth-related challenges. But do remember that growth-related challenges can be resolved with tools that focus on improving your employee happiness. And this is irrespective of whichever sector you might belong to. Because at the end of the day, it's humans who run your systems. And when they are happier, they're going to work better, perform better, and sort out the bottlenecks. So when I speak about benefits of incorporating happiness in your company agenda, I actually mean focusing on the people agenda in your organization. Because when they are empowered and happy, they will transform and work collaboratively well together. Employee happiness should therefore be a top priority for every business and not just an afterthought. So how do we as happiness coaches implement happiness at your workplace? It's a very scientific and carefully curated process and tailor-made for each organization according to their specific requirements and structure. I'm going to show you a slide now to give you an idea of the broad outlines on which we work to build this framework. Can you please show the slide? As you can see, it's a cycle, and there are four steps with the cycle. The first step is to measure, then define, then live, and then sustain. So by measure, what do I mean? We do a happiness audit for the current mood of the organization through a set of surveys, questionnaires, and conversations. This helps to understand where the organization is at currently. The next stage is to define. Based on your company's values, manifesto, and ideology, one must define the core values, cultures, and beliefs, and then break it down into behaviors to ensure that the behaviors give you the results that you want in your workplace. The next stage is live. Here, what we do is we design tools for the required initiatives based on the behaviors. And then we launch the initiatives for the organization and we ask the organization to start to live that initiative. At this stage, it is important to perform checks and balances and make any adjustments if needed. The fourth step is sustain. Once a system is working, it is important to monitor whether the organization is sustaining the system and maximizing benefits. So overall, the implementation of this model successfully creates a culture of positivity in the organization. I do want to point out here that while happiness among employees is not going to insulate you against all problems, it will definitely reduce how many you face because you are getting the very best from your people. Can we please remove the slide? So what do I mean when I speak about happiness at work? It is often linked to nice office facilities, swanky office chambers, fancy layouts of free food, perhaps a game room with a ping pong table. It's also linked to having flexible working hours or to social events, both in person and virtual, where colleagues have fun with each other. All these initiatives are very important, but happiness at work is much, much deeper than this. Let me explain. So when I conduct my corporate trainings and I ask my participants to think of and share a great experience that they have recently had at work, one that made them really happy, and ask them for the reason for that, trust me, the answer is never playing ping pong or the fancy free food. It's quite the opposite. Most of the experiences that they share are task-related. Our participants explain to me how they are using their strengths to either fix a complex work issue or make progress in a task or a project, or how they have successfully fulfilled a company objective and contributed positively to some mission at work. So this shows us that happiness at work is a state of emotional well-being. And this can be fully achieved as a direct result of unleashing and utilizing our talents and our skills at work and will get us fantastic results. Can I show the next slide, please? As you can see in this slide, happy employees perform better, are more engaged with work, get better results, and will be more loyal to the organization. Also, when you get results using your strengths, you are happier. So it's like a beautiful circle and cycle. And now this process has been adopted by many companies globally. This is especially true for the new generations, the millennials and the Gen Z, or as they are now called, the centennials. Together, these two segments form a significant percentage of our workforce, and happiness and job content is very much a priority for them. Therefore, we need to have policies in place to make our employees happy with the content of their work so that they can perform at their optimum best and help us to achieve our growth targets. Can you remove the slide, please? A very successful tool to achieve this workplace happiness is the tool of job crafting, where you let people do more of what makes them happy. In other words, you let people craft their own job. This allows people to showcase and exhibit their own skills in the workplace. Professor Amy Resnitsky of Yale University has done a study on this, and she shows us that the one common trait in the happiest people in organizations is that they had all modified, tweaked, and shaped their jobs to make it more meaningful so they could use their talents better. Now, please note that by job crafting, I don't mean that you only do the tasks that you like. Not at all. We all have a job description and responsibilities to accomplish. So we have to work within the framework and really sculpt our job, modify some tasks, and use our own individual talents more. You can strike right from the top, from the CEO, and follow this process all the way through your employee roster. As a leader, you must give yourself permission to do more of what makes you happy. Not only will you feel better, you will lead by example. Remember, happiness is contagious. And when people do what makes them happy, amazing things happen. Now, statistics show us that 70% of our waking hours are spent at work. And that's a huge amount of time. So it should definitely be the best part of our lives, right? Now, how can we do that? Harvard professors Ed Diner and Martin Seligman did a very detailed study on what makes people truly happy. And their conclusion was social connections. They emphasized that strong social connections are by far the greatest predictor of happiness, more than any other factor. And similarly, in another very interesting study, done by the global analytics firm Gallup, they found close work friendships boost employee satisfaction by 50%. And people with a best friend at work are 7 times more likely to be fully engaged at their work. Now, earlier, we used to believe that we should keep our work life and our home life separate, and friends at work was really not a thing. Today, this data has made us all realize that we need to change this way of thinking and functioning. Today, it is important to encourage employees to feel for each other like family, to become close to each other. And we need to break the taboo that you shouldn't have friends at work or you don't have to have relationships at work. Earlier, it was not encouraged to have your partner or your spouse in the same company. I know it was very much true when I used to work in the bank. But this reality has now changed in many companies. So as organizations, we need to focus on fostering our bonds among other people and improve our happiness quotient at the workplace. Now, there are many tools for us to achieve this, and I'm going to share a few. We do the typical company dashboard, the college boards, the sharing of photos on the company portals, the gratitude wall, and they're all very effective. But I want to show 4 more tools to all of you today. So the first tool I want to speak about is installing a bell on each floor, which I call the bell of awesomeness. When someone on a floor reaches a sales or a marketing target, we should celebrate that by ringing a bell on the floor. So everyone on the floor shares in the happiness of success. The other thing we can do is install a green bulb on each floor. Green is the color for peace and calm. So whenever a manager or a supervisor notices that there is a situation of stress and anxiety building up, perhaps there's a difficult project deadline that's coming up, switch on this green bulb. This will indicate that we all on the shop floor need to calm down. You need to take a pause, 60 seconds of deep breath, and get back to work. This shows that as an organization, we appreciate and we notice the efforts of what our colleagues are going through. We are sharing their emotion or stress. My third suggestion is the Culture Day. India is a land of such diversity in culture, and each one is so beautiful, so unique, and so colorful. So each organization has people from so many different cultures. So perhaps once a month, you can have a Culture Day and celebrate a different culture. Give them a budget, let them organize some food and dance and music. Now these Culture Days, they help to create the social network within the company, like a social cohesion. And the ripple effect of this is that people connect very well with each other. These close connections improve then the team members' individual performance as well as the group performance. It reduces group conflict, creates more cooperation, and therefore greater overall performance in all the tasks. Now, I've met some senior management and they've debated with me on the opportunity cost of giving 2 work hours once a month for a social event. And my point to them and to all of you today is, if you give 2 hours, please know that you're not wasting 2 hours of your working cycle. Instead, you're consciously building strong employee connections and bonding. And like I said before, strong social connections lead to people loving their job more, and you will have higher retention, better performance, your surpassing of your growth targets, building your brand goodwill. So there are only pluses, as you can see. Can I show the next slide, please? So my fourth tool is based on the premise of frequent appreciation. Appreciation and validation are key ingredients for an environment of work happiness. And as Richard Branson says, like flowers flourish on water, people flourish on praise. So you have to praise frequently. And I'm referring here to genuine, honest praise. And I want to share an example of how this works. The company Facebook did a very simple and extremely successful exercise based on this concept for 21 days and had fabulous results. Each employee was asked to spend the first 2 minutes of their day and sent a note of appreciation, a single positive email to a colleague praising or thanking them for something they had done the previous day that had a positive impact on them. It could be something as simple as thanking them for help on a particular task, or something more meaningful along the lines of thanking them for being their confidant or support at work, or just saying thank you for covering for me when I had so much work yesterday. Anything true, anything genuine, anything from the heart. This simple action works as a double whammy for happiness. The person receiving the email is, of course, very happy. And the person who is sending the email and providing praise to somebody else, once you do this for 3 days, you start getting addicted to praising someone else because it makes you feel amazing about yourself too. And the real benefits happen after 21 days when the social connection scores multiply in the organization. And there is a significant impact both on the organization as a whole and your growth potential. Can we remove the slide? This success story that I just shared has made waves and was brought to the attention of the president of the nationwide insurance company in the United States. Now, he was a numbers guy, and he used to believe that happiness research was fluff. However, he did get convinced when he looked at the result numbers of companies who had had success with this program. And so he reluctantly implemented this intervention. Once this was done, it was so powerful. A nationwide insurance company had a 50% rise in revenue and a 237% rise in application rates for people who were applying to join them. Google flew out to understand what they were doing right. So do remember, it's the simple tools that work. We don't need to make things very complicated. As we've discussed today, happiness doesn't happen by accident. There is a science to it, and using it will give you a significant competitive advantage. It is a choice you make, but it requires effort from us, both at the individual level and at the leadership and corporate level. As leaders, it is not just a moral obligation. It is a business obligation too, to make sure that the people on our team are in a positive state. And do remember that happiness is a core and basic value. And how do you inculcate a value in someone else? Let's start at the family model. How does a child learn values? Yes, we teach them. But isn't it more about what they observe about us as parents and elders? They observe the values that we are living. And that's how they learn their core values. It's the same in a company. So to all of you who are here today, make happiness your value. Make it your choice. Lead and live by example. We speak a lot now about COVID being an infectious disease and other different contagious infections. Do remember, smiles, positivity, happiness, and optimism is actually contagious. Thank you for your time, and I wish each and every one of you the best on your individual and collective journeys with happiness. Thank you.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
You're on mute.
Am I audible now? Sorry for the inconvenience. Thank you, Dia. That was really, really fantastic. Moving on, we learned a lot of things from her presentation and the way she narrated about how a corporate happiness can be symbolized and can be brought upon so that our people who are working day and night can be part of this entire happiness gamut gives a lot of learning. And we as people who are part of corporate, who are working with teams, we really get motivated when we hear such inspirational dialogues and also some tips which she offered. We are very much thankful to Dia for such a wonderful and informative session. Thank you so much. Moving on, I would now go to Mr. Anindo Dash. He is the head marketing and corporate communication Infinity Group. Mr. Das is an ecosystem enabler. He's playing an important role in bringing new companies to Salt Lake Sector 5. And we all have been a witness to that. Companies like Mindtree, Gensar, L&T Infotech, Prestige, TTK, BSH, and so on and so forth. Numbers just add when it comes to Anindo. Here he has added as much into the corporate kitty. Currently, he's heading the marketing and corporate communications of Infinity Group. He is associated with Vidya Bharati Akhil Bharatiya Shiksha Sansthan and Sri Aurobindo Society. Anindo has been working with the Chamber Fraternity and Chamber with Bengal Chamber for quite a long time. And we have time and again come up to him with different kind of approaches. And he has always been with us. He and Infinity Group is doing something which is really, really wonderful. And I would now request Anindo to take it over and please share with us what happiness means to Infinity Group.
Yeah, Thank you. Thank you, Shukarna. Thank you, Dia. I thank the chamber for conceptualizing such a wonderful program. Dia has so wonderfully articulated about the concept of happiness in the workplace. She has given her perspective. So I'll just take 3 more minutes to add on to whatever she has said. Yes, true that we all have been chasing after happiness, and yet 99% have failed to attain it fully. It's a misconception that only those who are outwardly living, active, they are fit, earning well, with loads of materials, they are only enjoying happiness. If you analyze it, the entire concept of happiness, has been misinterpreted. And the main reason being, what I feel, a lot of weightage has been given to the mind and not to the heart. That's one of the basic issue. Our originality, if we see, it has always been freedom. One of its aspect of this freedom is happiness. And because we are somehow separated from our originality, we are always seeking for happiness. Now, how we got separated from the originality, can be a separate topic of discussion. But one of the reasons for our happiness to go away is because, it got clouded with a lot of ego and its aspects. If you see, desires, greed, fear, attachments, all those are aspects of the ego. And but the question is, how all of this has come to us? That's a question, that how it has come, it is coming to us and affecting us. One basic way of understanding is all these are coming from outside as hidden, invisible forces. The people we mix with, the environment we live in, all this matters. And these hidden forces, they enter, they clog us, and they sit in our subconscious plane layer after layer. And the moment they get an opportunity, it gets triggered. It triggers the mind, the vital, and the body, and then all those kind of depression and the unhappiness aspect comes in. So basically, what we are seeking as items of happiness, all are those agents of this hidden adverse forces which are attacking us and creating those layers after layer. Now, if you see the senior citizen community as well, and if we analyze it, they each and every day they have been fed from various channels that the senior citizens are irrelevant, they are burdened, they are sick, and they are retired. And all this mental clogging making the senior citizens more lonely, and they are under fear. And that is the biggest problem which we are seeing in the senior citizen community. So there are two cents, for the senior citizens. I would like to say that, happiness is always, as Dia was saying, it is always within you. Second point is, let's be more conscious, let's be more aware, and let's be more vigilant to reject those forces which are coming from outside, or those which are sitting inside, we need to uproot it. And the third aspect is, get involved in activities which helps you to progress consciously. And by saying this, I would like to tell that Infinity is coming up with it's a very different kind of project called Jagriti Dham, meant for the senior citizens. We are launching it in the month of October. It's outside the main city, a little bit in the serene outskirt at the Diamond Harbour Road. The idea is, the project is a symbol of happiness. The senior citizens who wants to have a second kind of a life with a purpose. This is a kind of environment which we are focusing on, and we are telling everybody to come in. Please join us. Bengal Chamber has also partnered with us, And we will we are planning for a tour soon. I think post Pujo we will do that, and we can. I invite you all to come and experience this concept of royal aging at Jagriti Dham. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Anindo. And we as a chamber, we always feel and we always go by the thinking that we should respect what we have and we should respect our elders. As we all know that this generation is working very fast. Life is moving very fast. And in this process, we should not make our seniors feel left out. Their happiness is something which is very important to us, because if your parents are not happy, you are not happy. And if you are not happy, you're not becoming a productive individual. So it is a complete circle which is affecting their lives directly. So as a chamber, we support this initiative, and the chamber has been working on the mental health of senior citizen for quite a long. We have our mission to be part of the senior citizen group, because without them, we won't have survived till now. So as a chamber, we support Jagriti Dham, of course, and as we have planned in the future, we will be taking up initiatives along with Jagriti Dham, where we feel that we get the opportunity to work with the senior citizens of India, and we can contribute something to them. With this, I would now like to directly come up to the question answer session. We have been getting questions from our audience. First of all, I would like to ask Ms. Dia that you spoke about a happiness gym, working the happiness muscle. Can you share one or two tips for this?
Yeah, I really believe that, you know, just like we use the word gym for fitness, we have to use the same word for our mind, so that we remind ourselves that we need to keep that muscle active. And there are many things that you can do, and that's what I do in my trainings. But I'm going to give you two very simple tips right now. The one thing is, you know, we spend a lot of time on social media, all of us. We wake up in the morning, we check our phone, we check our Instagram, we check Facebook. And then throughout the day, we keep doing that, you know, subconsciously, whether we're in the car, in between meetings. So I want to tell you, you know, what are we looking at when we look at Facebook and Instagram and social media? We're actually looking at digitally enhanced images of the people that we are wanting to know more about. Those are really not real photos, right? Every photograph has gone through a filter. So when we look at these images, we think we're feeling happy. We think that we're looking at them and sharing and being a part of the happiness. But actually, if you go onto Google and you write, Instagram makes me or Facebook makes me, you're not going to get the answer happy. Instead, Google itself will tell you that these activities, they make us sad, frustrated, upset, depressed, even jealous. You can check this out on your own on Google, you know. So actually what we're doing is just draining our unhappiness by spending so much time on social media. Now, we do need to be aware of what's happening in the world, but we must know the effect it's having on us. So we must monitor what we're doing. The other thing I want to suggest is, you know, doing a random act of kindness every single day. Now, when I say random act, I'm not talking about making huge donations, etc. Please do that if you want to. But I'm talking about really small, simple acts of kindness. Just maybe holding the door open if you see somebody. Ananda spoke about the elderly. Just paying a little more attention without making it look like an effort. Maybe making a phone call to somebody, one of your relatives, going and giving them a visit. Just, distributing to somebody you see on the road, maybe some sweets, some biscuits, a bottle of water. Just saying something really nice to somebody, a really nice compliment, which is genuine. What happens is, you know, like I said, happiness is contagious and kindness is directly proportional to happiness. So the kinder you are as a person, you're making the person happy because you're saying something nice or doing something nice for them. You're also doing the same for yourself. So what I tell my clients is, Every single day on your phone in the notes section, just write down that one simple activity that you did on that day. Just one line, because nobody writes gratitude journals anymore. It's very cumbersome. So just on your phone in your notes section. On a Monday morning, when you're driving to work or before you're starting work, because now it's a lot of digital work, just go through your notes and read in the last 7 days the nice things and the acts of kindness you have done. There is no question of Monday morning blues, because you are going to feel so good about yourself. That's your happiness mantra for the rest of your week. So it's very simple, but these are the things that work always.
Thank you so much. I would also like to know from you that what is the one tip that you would suggest we can use when we are having a very bad day?
Yeah, that's a great question, Sukanya, because I think we all go through that. Even me as a happiness coach, so people ask me, are you always happy now because you're a happiness coach? I'm not at all. And I'm sure Ananto will agree with me. We all have our moments, right? So what I tell people to do is to maintain a brag book. Now, a brag book only for yourself. I'm not talking about blowing your trumpet in a public forum. Have your own brag book for yourself. And again, I say, use the notes section on your phone and make a note every time you have an achievement, you hear something nice about yourself, you reach a milestone. Document all these moments and these instances on your phone in your notes section. Whenever you're feeling a little low, go through them. It becomes like your power bank. It's like a life raft for you. Because when you read the good things about yourself, you feel validated. You realize that you are actually very nice, you're very good, you're very powerful, you're very strong, and that moment will pass by.
Absolutely, absolutely well noted and very well said, true. The last question which I would now, for the time being, would like to ask you is, how do you deal with a difficult boss or a difficult colleague?
Ananda, would you like to take that?
Earlier when we started the career, this was a very difficult part. But now, over the time, one thing what I implement and I have understood that, there is nothing called a boss. The only supreme boss is above us, and as long as we know that nothing we are doing, everything has been done through us, everybody is good. Everybody is, we can gel along and we can unite and move along. The moment that individuality part is coming up, the ego sense is coming, then those differences come up. And then we focus more on that individual, the holistic picture we forget. So again, as I said, the originality has to be restored. As long as we keep restoring the originality, there will be more unity. And that's how we can progress each and every day.
That's true. And I also want to add to what you're saying, Ananda. So what I tell, this is a very common problem because I also work as a life coach and I have a lot of clients who come to me. And this is a really common problem, especially with the slightly younger people who are not so senior maybe.
Right.
So what I tell all of them, and I'll just put it in very brief, and since Sukanya did ask the question. Sukanya, what I suggest is, firstly, put yourself in the shoes of your boss to try and understand why are they behaving in that particular manner. Maybe they have a lot of deadlines, a lot of pressure on them. Maybe they have a really difficult boss too. That's one thing. Secondly, look at yourself to understand maybe you could be doing something wrong too. It's so easy for all of us to blame everyone else. Look within. Maybe the problem is possibly with you too. These are the first basic steps. If these are not going to solve your problem, then don't gossip about it. Don't start talking to other colleagues and telling them that, my boss did this and my boss did that. Because, Chinese whispers works in every organization. That story is going to reach your boss. And in such a distorted fashion that it's only going to make your relationship worse. Instead, possibly ask your boss through his secretary or even directly, send him an email, ask for 15 minutes and say, I have a problem at work which I want to talk to you about. Take it, upfront and go and discuss with your boss. Write the points down before you go. Anyway, when you start writing the reasons you're upset with somebody, you'll suddenly realize that out of the 50 things that you thought were wrong, maybe only 5 are genuinely wrong. When you start reading what you write, you realize many of them are not so significant. So go with those 5 significant things to your boss and try and sort it out across the table. Today, like Ananda said, they're all very open to conversation. If that doesn't work too, go to the HR in your office with that same set of problems. I'm sure they'll be able to help you out. Today, the HR is very, very open to conversations, open to being there. Earlier, we used to resist going to the HR because we used to believe that they're just the ears and the eyes of the senior management and they're not interested in our problems. But that's not true anymore. They're well-trained. They know how to take care of their employees. So there are many options for you.
Absolutely, Diya. As my experience say and my boss says that transparency and communication Absolutely. Are the two verticals which yes. makes any employee relationship strengthen, and that's what we follow, transparency and communication. And we Absolutely. Know that we can reach to our bosses at any time, 24/7, whenever we need. So that's Thank fantastically you. Answered by you. Now coming to Anindo. Anindo, like we know, adapting to age-related changes is vital to successfully do the aging process and also to go through the well-being process. So when we are talking about happiness in senior citizens, happiness for us all, we would like to know from you the focus or the abilities of Royal Aging which you have thought of. Or in other way, what we wanted to ask from you, aging has its challenges. So can you give us the features that are focused in Jagriti Dham, which introduces aging in a different way to our senior citizen group?
Yeah, for Jagriti Dham, when we conceptualized, when we thought that, okay, this will not be a typical, Vidhashram kind of a center. So this is not a Vidhashram. It is a center where the senior citizens are, firstly, they are empowered to take the decision. It is not like their children will, it's a burden and they will keep their parents over here. No, every day we are dealing with senior citizens from different parts of the world who has got Bengal Connect. They're so empowered. They want to, with like-minded people, they want to, spend their rest of their life. That is something, a change which we are seeing. And that is, and the entire center has been built keeping that in mind. That's number one. Number two, we are not saying leave everything and come. There can be, for certain periods or certain years of their time, they can stay in this particular community and again go back to their permanent residence, kind of a thing. Third, as I said in my talk also, the environment plays a very important role, because every day, if you see the senior citizens in the news channel, in the serials, they are already been fed that they are retiring. There is nothing called retirement. That is something which we are also promoting. That age is not the is just a number. Age, there is nothing called after certain age you cannot do anything. So the activities we are planning up in that particular center, where with the youth, that the youth and the senior citizens, if the both the energies combine, there can be remarkable things in the society. We can do remarkable work in the society. And only through work, the progress can happen. And work as from a point of view, karma yoga point of view, not from, I'm doing a work and my ego is going up, my desire, I'm doing some social work, my desire is going up. It is not like that. The entire concept, the center has been, we are building the center in such a way that all this kind of, we can call it an education, will be imparted, so that all those things which has been done in the past can be relearned again, and a new life can be led from hereafter. Keeping all those small aspects are very important for the senior citizens, that's how we are shaping it up.
Great. like it is like respecting the legacy and creating another legacy and another run for the
right. You know, they must have lost their confidence. So we are just telling them, okay, boss, you are not irrelevant. You are important. So
that's very important. Yes. To making, giving them a work mission and giving them the small joys and pleasures of life, which make them feel important.
Right.
And as we, Arindo, say that respect the old when you are young.
Yes.
So what do you think, what should be the role of the young people in making the old people feel confident? And how Jagriti Dham has planned involving the young people to hold the hands of the old people and getting them in a better shape?
See, what if you see, we in the entire team of this Jagriti Dham, it's only the young people who are, our chairman has told us that let the youth drive the entire thing. So when we are talking to the senior citizens, they are also feeling a kind of they're feeling that yes, the youth of Bengal also has a responsibility towards the senior citizens. So in all our approaches, like whenever we are talking to the different senior citizens, it's the young people who are talking, and they are also understanding it. Initially, they had a kind of a blockage, but now they're understanding that, okay, they're feeling very happy also that the youth of Bengal is coming forward, thinking about the senior citizens of Bengal. So all the programs and the entire project has been driven by youth within Infinity. That's how we have planned it.
Absolutely great, because as we also as a chamber, we feel that we should come up and we should hold the hands of the people who are more experienced. Like, we don't call them aged or old, rather they are rich in experiences and help us in redrafting or rerouting ourselves always. They are coming to you. I would like to know, what do you feel like, what should be the role of young people be to make the senior people be happy, and how important happiness is as a quotient for the senior people?
That's a great question, because I also take care of my mother and my mother-in-law. And I think the most important thing that we need to teach young people and also remind ourselves every time is that we need to make them feel important. Not that we are just taking care of them. That's not at all the idea. They must feel wanted. They must feel relevant. So whatever you can do to keep them relevant, and young children need to be taught this value from literally from the time they're taught anything. You know, I think the values to take care of family, the value to respect elders, the love for your country, these are very simple values, but very, very important. And I think all children need to have these basic values in place. And then you build on them with stories and with different things, you know, through school. And so as you grew into adulthood, that's what happened with me, you know. It was taught to me as a value. And I believe that that's why I carry this legacy forward in my family. And I hope I've done it successfully for my children too. And I really believe, and I urge all parents always, please teach this as a value to your children, to take care of the people at home and respect them and make them feel relevant. That's very important. You know, taking care is not just calling the doctor and getting the medicines organized. That is our duty. But there is a different thing. You have to make them feel wanted too.
Absolutely. And as I mentioned in the very beginning, that happiness is like a circle. If any one end of the circle gets detached, you won't get the complete result.
Absolutely.
So when we talk about happiness for corporates, when we talk about growth of corporates, it cannot be complete without this entire circle of respecting each other, respecting our seniors, their experiences, and stretching our hand forward towards them when they need us. And we have to do it at our young age. We don't say, India is a kind of a society where we don't promote old age homes in that way, but senior care living properties are, or senior care living assistance is very much required in today's life, because the young generation nowadays are completely busy running after their own career, settling their own lives. So sometimes our senior people, they feel left out. And that's where we all have to come together, hold their hands, and assure them, as Anindo said, that you are important. You are valuable to us. That gives us happiness. So
the fantastic thing, Anindo, what you've just spoken about, what you're doing. In fact, I'm going to book my room there for my future. It sounds amazing.
We will plan a good program over there with Dia. Yeah. Very soon after puja.
I was talking about booking my accommodation.
Okay.
For my senior living, because it sounds so nice.
Absolutely. And as a chamber, as I said, this today's discussion, I think, was absolutely phenomenal. Like, we started from young age, where people are in corporate, running after their career, building their careers, tasting the success, and then slowly coming to an age where they need to taste their life in a different way. They need to enjoy their life. And it is at that time their happiness gets counted. So in that process, the young people need to come up, give some time, hold their hands, and gain happiness for themselves, so that they can again contribute back to the society. So with this, I think today's session was a very fantastic and encouraging session for us. Hopefully all of you must have enjoyed a lot, and we are very much thankful to Dia as well as Anindo for sharing their views and making us feel that how important happiness is, and what is the value of happiness? Happiness cannot be bought. Happiness cannot be taken from somebody. Happiness cannot be booked. It has to be achieved. And one can achieve happiness through himself or herself, by herself, right? So you have to be happy to gain happiness. With this, I would like to now give a formal vote of thanks on behalf of the chamber to you all. Ladies and gentlemen, it is such an honor for us to get the opportunity to thank our distinguished panelists, valued delegates and guests and members of the media. I extend my gratitude to Ms. Dia Jaiswal, founder Empowerful, and Mr. Anindo Dash, head marketing and corporate communications, Infinity Group, to take out time from their busy schedule to grace the occasion. Thank you for inspiring and encouraging us with your words on this special day. As discussed, it is quite imperative to state that happiness is more than a good feeling or a yellow smiley face. It's the feeling of truly enjoying your life and the desire to make the very best of it. Happiness is the secret sauce that can help us to do our best. When our lives are rich with positive emotions, great relationships, strengthens us to practice and sense the purpose of life. We are ready to accomplish things. That is how setting and achieving goals gives us something to put our energy into. Let us see how we make a difference with the small word happiness. I must thank Lifestyle Committee of the Bengal Chamber for taking this initiative forward. I would also like to thank all our partners who have been there with us in organizing such a fantastic session. Once again, our thanks to Woodlands Multispeciality Hospital Limited, Infinity Group, and My Kolkata, the Telegraph Online, for joining us. Last but not at all the least, with the constant support from the partners and participants, we promise to bring before you more such programs. And on behalf of the chamber, it is always a pleasure to bring to you all such kind of session which inspires us to achieve more. With that, I would like to thank you all and wish you all a very good evening. Bye-bye.